Happy afternoon. Warm welcome to one and all present here. We aim above the mark to hit the mark. The famous quote by Ralph Waldo Emerson, "The sky is the limit, aim high." This is very much true in our theme of today's webinar on cloud SAAS evolution. Science is proud to host this virtual webinar as a platform for young learners to update industry requirements during this COVID-19 pandemic. The data science are happy to become one and all present here for the international webinar on recent trends in intelligent system, cloud and enterprise architecture. I am indeed very happy to welcome our renowned and honorable resource person, Mr. Anbu Ganapathi Muppidathi, Senior Vice President and Global Markets Head, Cognizant Technology Solutions, TNET, New Jersey, USA, for this August gathering today for our webinar to deliver a special lecture on cloud SAAS evolution to enrich our knowledge for another 90 minutes. We are grateful to our eminent resource person, Mr. Anbu Ganapathi Muppidathi. Hearty welcome, sir, for sparing your valuable time to enlighten our dynamic and enthusiastic participants. I am glad to welcome all our beloved professors, Dr. P. Thangave, Professor and Head, Dr. M. Swarnam, Dr. S. Gopinathan, and Dr. B. Lavanya of our department and other university professors from various colleges all over Tamil Nadu and from various states. I extend my warm welcome to ever energetic research scholars, young student friends from our department, dark places, eagerly awaiting update their knowledge, as famous saying, கற்றது கை மண்ணளவு கல்லாதது உலகளவு. I am sure that this session on cloud SAAS evolution prove an update. உலகம் உங்கள் கையில். The world is in your palm top. It is very much true. Anywhere, anytime, you can share the high-end computing from cloud services from your palm top or laptop or desktop. We are going to hear this from our eminent resource person. I have a great privilege to introduce our ever energetic and potential resource person, Mr. Anbu Ganapathi Muppidathi, Senior Vice President and Global Market Head, Cognizant Technology Solutions, TNEC, New Jersey, USA. We are fortunate to have you with sir today. He has done his postgraduate at Allahabad University. He is a gold medalist from the post-graduation. And he has done same from Duke's University. And he started his career in different capacities from Cognizant as software engineer and manager in projects. And he has been worked as a director, banking and financial services, and he served as a vice president at banking and financial services, and he has served as senior vice president digital systems and technology, and present he is holding senior vice president and global market head for about 25 years in Cognizant itself. He has done a very good contribution to Cognizant Technology Solutions. He is a trusted advisor, C-level across multiple industries in breakthrough thinking, competitiveness, strategy, operations, and transformations. Currently, he is a member of Cognizant Executive Leadership Team and a senior leader in the company's digital system and technology line of business. Over a period of 25 years, he promoted from being an IT outsourcing firm to becoming a world-class Consulting and Technology Organization. He has contributed regulatory environments in cognizant and multiple technology waves. He has incubated many practices and built them into multi-billion dollar business for cognizant. He has got a rich 3 decades of demonstrated business and technology experience in the global markets with specialization in cloud, data, and security. He is a member of the Harvard Business Review Advisory Council, Forbes Technology Council, and he is a winner of IDG CIO Magazine's 2019 Global Ones to Watch Award. So,
Over to Mr. Anu Ganapathy, Upidadi, Senior Vice President. Take over. Good morning. Good evening, sir. Am I audible? Yes, audible. Audible. Yes, audible.
Share my screen.
Yeah.
Are you able to see the screen now?
Yes, sir.
Excellent. Thank you. All right. Greetings, everybody. Thank you for the kind words of introduction. I'm excited to be here. I want to talk about the SAAS evolution and how it creates opportunities for all of us, so that those of you who are in the academics can align your priorities of learning, and those of us who are in the business can accelerate the efforts towards making our businesses stronger. And this is especially an interesting topic for me because my job as the global markets head of enterprise application services is to provide services to our thousands of customers in and around the software as a services domain. So it's my job and that's what I'm doing every day. So my learning is in this field. So I hope I learn with operations useful to all of you. So I'm really excited. Now the word evolution, I really like this topic because I always want to go back and look at history of what exactly has happened, why things have happened the way that for me to understand how I should be functioning today and I should be able to take it to the future. So I always want to go back and look at the history. And this word evolution is critically important because, in my humble opinion, this kind of dictates everything that's changing around in the past, now, and in the future. So this word evolution was first publicized by Dr. Holland in the year 1859, when he published his work, A Theory of Evolution. And I have summarized it here, that this is the process of change that you adapt to the environment, changing environment. When environments change, if organisms don't change, then they will not be able to adapt. That's the foundational theory of this. And this is proven in many phases. And what's so interesting is, at the time that he introduced the theory, nobody agreed, and there were a lot of debates, but then there were a lot of times in the past that folks went back and proven it. And the latest one is just last month, a doctoral student in a British university has proven one of the theories, one of the predictions that Darwin made in the subspecies section using data analytics. That Charles Darwin never had an opportunity to use data analytics, but now in the days of computers, these students use analytics to prove what Charles Darwin predicted some thousands of years ago. So this is a phenomenal theory, and this is especially true for not just organisms. This is true for teams, businesses, and software as a service construct. It's true. Now, that's why I have structured my presentation into these three constructs. I want to talk about why all these changes are happening. What is the motivation? What is the attraction? There should be a reason why this evolution in these software as a service models happened. Why is that happening? And I want to talk about the economic cost of cloud. Then I want to spend some time talking about the specific changes that are happening in the SaaS market. And what are some of the drivers? You that service providers like myself, TCS, Infosys, and these companies are using, what are those specific drivers of change? I want to spend some time. And then finally, I want to talk about what are some opportunities that you have, what are some adjustments that all of us are making. So you as students, what does this SaaS evolution mean to you? You as research students, research scholars, what does this mean? What are some of the things that you can actually take home with you for you to take a fresh look at how things change? So I have structured in these three aspects. Hope you follow me. Now, I want to start with the attraction. Why is that the SaaS models are attractive? What are the benefits? And it's critically important. You have to understand this. And if you're a classroom, I would have quizzed you to see what are some of the things that you have seen. You, as a student and research scholars and teachers, you may have read about all these, but I want to just quickly summarize. What you see on the right-hand side is the benefits that you see. And these benefits are pretty straightforward. They are the low cost, lowest cost, the time to market, the ease of access, scalability, seamless integration. There are a bunch of that I have listed on the left-hand side that you know. Those are the benefits why in the first place customers are adopting this, why in the first place the platform providers, the Salesforce, SAP, Oracle, Microsoft Dynamics, you name any of the vendors that are out there producing these business applications and hosting it over a cloud and selling it to their customers. All of the benefits are listed, and most of the benefits are listed on the left-hand side. But you have to understand the critical composition of why the SaaS models are adapted for you to make a case on, is this real? Is this going to continue? Is this having a future? So for you to understand the promise, you have to see this. The right-hand side picture is a good one. That gives you an idea of how a capital-intensive project that can be done faster for a fraction of cost using cloud technologies. By means of cloud SaaS, what you see on the right-hand side, cost towards the optimized hardware, product maintenance, people, training. Time that you want to make an encryption fee that you pay and I'm figuring out how I'm going to learn, how I'm going to implement, how I'm going to manage the network, how I'm going to train my people to build more things, all of that can be avoided, just the subscription fee, you get your platform in and all it requires is why am I using this, what are the business cases and how am I going to configure and use. So cloud has shrunk the time to market, the cycle time. It also, because it is a proven or a mature product that you can be in, it certifies the quality, and because it is cloud, it is scalable. Because it is cloud, reachable to million people, gives you that on the left-hand side. So cloud is a proven model, is an attractive model, and it's already in mainstream. It's not like people are talking about why cloud now. Cloud is already adopted, cloud is already mainstream. So the question for us is, for us to understand what are some changes that has happened in the past and what are some of the changes that are happening now and what is that we should be prepared if we want to be relevant for future. So my intention of showing you this slide is for you to understand the benefits against the traditional application development or on-premise product implementations. As IT professionals, we should always ask the question of, what is the most cost-effective way of developing a solution within that time, the best of the quality. But what is the way? If you think of that, the most probably that you may end up in subscribing to a cloud solution. That is known, that is discussed, that is well tested now that it's in the mainstream. And there's also a larger reason why I wanted to show this first, because you all, when you start learning any new SaaS technology, or if you want to do any research in SaaS related topic, you got to question the current benefit of that technology. What can be done to accelerate the benefits? And that should be your learning, that should be your research. What are the other benefits that this technology that you have chosen that can produce? New use cases, new ways of implementing it, new ways of automating it. When you check and when you question all that, that's how you know it. That's how you contribute to the development. And if you want to shine in the world of SaaS, those are the questions that you're going to ask, and that will give you a unique space, because it is a very crowded marketplace. You will learn that in the next few slides. It's a very crowded marketplace, and for you and me to make a difference, those are the questions that we need to ask, or that we have to understand what exactly are the current benefits, what exactly are the current positioning for us to transform that to a new way of thinking, new way of using. Those are the ways that you as students, researchers, and teachers are working. Now, one more slide on the promise. This is my favorite slide. You know, this kind of shows changing the world today. Now, this is a chart you may can see. It was published pre-COVID, so this has to be adjusted to some of the post-COVID realities. But I wouldn't expect any major change. I'll talk about that one. And if any of you have a question of what are some leading edge technologies or what are some disrupting technologies that I think that you may want to learn for the future, this is it. What you see on the left-hand side are those top technologies that are changing the world today. So if you're interested in pure core technologies, that's what you want to learn. So what you see here is this bar charts. The dark blue tells you the minimum spend that McKinsey is expecting that the whole world is going to spend by 2025. And the light blue chart you see is the maximum spend. So this basically is the range of dollars that are going to be spent in the next 5 years. So that is an easy way for us to check. If the larger the bar, then that's where the world is going to spend more money, and that's where the future is. The COVID has accelerated the adoption of these technologies, and COVID has now introduced questions on life sciences as an industry, sensor-driven technologies for coronavirus-related detection, and many of those digital medicine, digital technologies in the world of hospitals, etc. But all that, even though you don't see that as a line item, but all of that can be covered in the top four, and even in any of those top five or six on the left-hand side, because it's all related to the mobile, it's all related to 5G, it's all related to AI, that is listed as the second one, automation of knowledge works for AI. Internet of Things is all driven, sensor-driven technologies and cloud, we will talk about that, and the robotics technologies. All of these will cover anything and everything that you see around the post-COVID realities. So these are the technologies that are changing the world, if you ask me. Here's another way of understanding the cloud promise, which is this listed here is the Gartner's predictions. Of course, it's a little bit predated in number, but what is now experienced is that this whole adoption has been accelerated. That Gartner thought that would happen in 2021 is happening already in 2020. So digital, because of COVID, it just will change some of these numbers, but the numbers are only increasing. And this also lists down different types of the cloud categories that I'll be covering with the details in next slide. But what you may want to look at that is the SAAS world, where Salesforce, SAP, Workday, Dynamics, all these business application service providers over the cloud. That's the pretty much the biggest spend category that you can see. And SaaS is a very crowded market, SaaS is a very promising. You can see that I have just boxed it out in red for you to see. The platform as a service, business process as a service that you see as the next few line items. They were, some of those are actually even predecessor to the software as a service. But they are also dominating. So when you talk about cloud, you have to talk about all of this. I want to spend more time on only the software as a service category in this presentation. I'm not going to spend time on the PaaS or infrastructure as a service or BPaaS. I will let you go and research yourself. SaaS is the focus area of presentation today. Now, you can also see that the platform as a service is those hyperscalers. You heard of this Amazon Web Services dominating market, Microsoft Azure, Google Cloud, Baba Cloud, all of those public cloud those actually were dominating because infrastructure and moving infrastructure over to cloud was the easiest thing and the point of cloud then that industry is there. That's why the AWS, Azure, Google Cloud, they actually dominated because they were the ones that created a platform for customers to platform when it comes to business process as a service, the fourth line item that you see. Companies like Cognizant, Accenture, IBM, they have invested and developed business applications for specific business processes, such as, to name you a few, say claims processing in insurance, order processing in retail, loan processing in banking. So they selected specific business processes, build applications, build cloud native applications for those, and host that over a cloud service, say Amazon or Azure or Google, and provide that as a service to their banking customers, their insurance customers, their retail customers, and then charge them a transaction-based, outcome-based pricing. That's how these companies make money. And that's how these technologies come together. So business process as a service is an advancement of a practical implementation of a process and let the customer worry about only the program, not worry about anything about application or infrastructure or network or data or security, nothing. The customers just focus on their business. That's an advancement. And that's a business process as a service. The cloud management, though the AWS, the Azure, Google, even though they provide cloud management tools, there are third parties like IBM hybrid cloud tools that they provide for you to administer the application movement on-prem to cloud, administering the applications in the cloud, monitoring the security, monitoring the performance. So IBM-like companies are having this whole slew of cloud management tools. So when customers want to implement or move to cloud, they don't need to sign up with just the one cloud provider. They can choose the best of the breed solution. They can choose a solution from Salesforce, a solution from Workday, a solution from SAP. Can choose the best of the tech stack from any provider and can connect them using the integration platforms and then host it in any of the public cloud providers that they can choose, Amazon or Google or Baba or whoever maybe, or not even the one provider, they can actually have the hybrid provider part in one, part the others and part in a third party, or part in-house. So now that they have the flexibility of looking across and choose the best of the breed solutions and then connect them, use them the way that they want. And all that without spending money to build it. Just that they buy the best of the products and connect, and all they do is orchestrate, they want the usage of and then move to the market. And just focus on their customers, focus on their core businesses, and they don't need to worry about how I'm going to do, how I'm going to build all that. Now, the last slide on the cloud promise. See, this is, this kind of gives you it's a beautiful slide. This gives you how the control and responsibilities shift from customer to the provider. That is critically important, and I'll explain why in a minute. But in the past, if you look at the left-hand side of the picture, the enterprise IT column, that's how the pre-cloud era, before the cloud was discussed, that's how IT was. So when I was in the college 30 years back, the IT, we talk about IT, all these boxes were there inside the customer's IT. The customers got to build their applications, they got to manage the servers, they got to set up and administer the network. Everything, soup to nuts, customers have to worry about it. They have to build, they have to run an IT division, a sizable IT division, overseeing all that. They have to manage everything. That's how IT works. But the problem was that businesses were spending a very valuable time on IT. Now, that's not their core business. Last week, you listened to a resource person from Nike talking about monolith and microservices architecture. Now, take Nike for example. Now, Nike as a company, their focus is on shoes and selling sporting goods and making money out of that. That's where they have to spend the time. Instead of spending the time on selling sports goods and making sports goods, if they are going to spend time on designing an application and designing a database and managing a database, that's actually a waste of time, waste of money, waste of energy. They have to focus on what is their core business. Everything else is context. Everything else is secondary. They have to reduce their time on everything else. They have to just focus on shoes and sporting goods and doing their research in sports-related activities. And that's true for a life sciences company. Just focus on drugs and medicine. True for banking company. Just focus on banking customers and how money is transacted. Instead, if they want to focus on IT, it's going to be a waste of time. That is exactly the benefit that the cloud introduces. That the responsibilities and the control that the customers had, just focus on their core and transfer that control, transfer that responsibilities to the providers, product providers, platform providers, and service providers. That's how the control moved, responsibilities moved. I would probably use the word control less, because businesses end up today have full control of their business. Whether you're IT or business or operations, they have the full control. But when it comes to the IT applications, the responsibility shifts so that they can focus on their businesses. This chart tells you how the responsibilities shift from customer to the provider, thereby businesses can focus on their business. Specialists, technology specialists, can just help the businesses do their business better, faster, cheaper, and improve the customer experience. So past were the days when systems were built to fit. Now people just come to their own business and overnight they can build a finance company for the billions of their customers that they want to have the next day. So it's customization is easy. Is promising, and what are the ways that you can measure that progress, and how much money that the whole world is going to spend on these technologies to prove to you that this is a promising technology. Now, this is my 30 minutes, and I'm going to stop for a few questions before I talk about what exactly is seeing in these. Okay, we now learn that these are the categories, but what exactly is changing in the eyes of the customers? What exactly is changing? Eyes of the platform providers. What exactly are changing from the service providers point of view. And I want to spend some time in the next 5 minutes, but I'm going to stop here for a few questions. Any questions that you see?
Yeah, good afternoon, sir. Good morning to you. Yeah. There are some questions what are the types of services available via computing, cloud computing model?
Yeah. See, when you talk about cloud computing, services and applications that are all enterprise applications. You have a whole slew of services like part of the type of those services so that you can move. Function. There are a bunch of applications that help businesses to track their employees. Colleges use to track their students. Public governmental organizations using that to track that the public. These technologies are contentious, for example, WorkTel, for example, SAAS, the SAP success factor, for example. These are all the examples of HCM services. Human capital management centers. That's one category. The supply chain management, SCM is another category. Oracle SCM, SP is ERP resources. And Microsoft has ERP applications. So there are a bunch of ERP enterprise or planning ERP type of services. That's another example of cloud computing related applications and services. Similarly, you have finance, you have sales, you have customer relationship management. I can go on and list specific types of services that are available as business applications. That's one way to answer your question. The second way to answer your question is you can play in a platform of infrastructures. That customers don't have servers and databases. That they want to sign up with Oracle, they are they want to sign up with sales and use their Tableau analytics. They want to sign up with SAP and use the SAP analytics. They want to Oracle and use Oracle data analytics. So the purpose of public, the cloud providers can keep them accountable, whether it comes to sales or networks or other things kind of activities, these platform providers provide the help. And the public cloud that I talked about is how many servers that we need, how we cover the server that we need, how we cover the database, the offer for the platform provider. So those are ways to look at it when you talk about what are the cloud computing services. Look at it in both ways. Apps, platforms, infrastructure as a service, cloud management. Look at it in those lines. That will answer your question on services. What's the next question?
The next question is, can we store our personal information in cloud, or how secure is our information in cloud, sir?
Cloud security is a concern. I think it's a real world. But if you really look at the plan that's been led to Microsoft, they invested a lot of time, energy, and money, and kind of perfected it. There are incidents that fortune the cloud security have come down over a period of time. It's a lot on it, but it is improving. It will later continue to assist and tell you that cloud security is an opportunity to do more research. Because that's the single and the most concern the customers have before they move their data over to cloud or before they move their applications over to cloud. The one big concern that they have is security. That has not been solved. That's an opportunity for research, opportunity for improvement. That's a topic that you can research. But if you ask me, it has tremendously improved. And network security, they are asked to do it. So I would expect that to improve over the next before we test this.
Yeah, which cloud platforms are used for large scale environment?
cloud platform is used in a large scale environment?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, see, this scale, almost all cloud providers, the first promise that they make is whether you buy the application, sign up with somebody to provision or hardware, database, or network, or whatever that is. What are the services that you are signing up with somebody? Everything is certifying that their solution is scalable. Overnight, you can scale it up or down, on demand. That's the fundamental promise that the cloud computing offers. So, scale need not be a question when it comes to cloud solutions. However, this is a critical attribute that you need to check when you design your application, when you want to post it over the net. If I want to touch upon, I did not listen to the lecture that you all heard on the microservices architecture, but if you really look at the fundamental concept of moving from monoarchitecture to microservices architecture is to decompose a complex architecture into unit-level, network-connected, independent units of components. That's how you split the cost capabilities. Now you have your application constructed in that way. Scalability is not an argument. You can scale up and down anytime you want. So to answer that question is, if you build your solution in a micro this way, scalability should not that way. You can see the application is, you don't know how it is designed, then you need to check it. That's in an application standpoint, answer your question. But if your question is, I have this large scale IT environment, my company has millions of data, millions of workflows, thousands of applications. If you think of your application size and user size, and application size are data flows, and if you're looking at the data, then you think of the branded companies like Amazon or Azure or Google, or some of those branded proven environments for you to post. So if you're looking for an IT environment, look for the top public cloud providers. If you're looking for a business application, check whether it is architected for you to not worry about. Okay, I think that is a good way to go to the next section, I guess. You're okay.
Few more questions. Shall we keep it for the next session, sir?
Yeah, keep it up on the end so that I'll finish it quickly.
Okay, sir. We'll continue.
Excellent. So, what you see here, now let me go quickly and summarize some of these so that I can give you some time to for more questions. So, what you see here is the reasons why consumers, what are some of the changes that they go through when they attend the cloud. And it's critically important for you to realize this, because ever since software success, that's what you see on the left hand side, they are nothing but the cost quality time to market and customer experience. 30 years back when I was coding in mainframe and client server technologies, those four were the primary drivers. And now, after 30 years, they're talking about cloud, artificial intelligence, the Internet of Things, and a bunch of other things. It is the same four things that are driving the production and the consumption and everything. Cost, quality, time to market, and customer experience. I sincerely believe that these four things are not going to change even 20 years from now. So you should always question, before you learn or before you design anything, is your solution, what you learn, answer these four. But now that cloud has just given some new answers to these four, and that's what you see on the right-hand side. And quickly to summarize, see, in a consumer standpoint, why they want to switch to the advanced cloud solutions? Why do they want to adopt? Why do they want to change solution A to solution B? why is that the cloud market is so crowded that they don't want to pick and choose and constantly change? The reasons are given in the right-hand side. Cost optimization, that's the number one reason. You know, by means of that, moving from custom-built applications to the cloud-enabled software as a service model, the total cost of ownership, that comes down. That's the number one, and you need to check whether the cost comes down before you adopt the cloud, before you switch from one cloud solution to the other cloud solution, that the cost is coming down, number one. The second one is the specialty, our industrialized solutions. The solution that you are picking up, does that put an industrialized special solution, or is that giving you a generic layout that you have to go in and get one? Configure it extensively. But is it speciality or is it just a general solution? That's the second reason why this SaaS products evolve and the consumers want to switch from product A to product B. By means of these products, the whole environment the customer does is modified so that the customer experience improves. Because they don't want to live with the old technology. They want to change the interfaces. Is it mobile enabled? That's a given. Every application must be accessible over a mobile phone. That's a given. Nobody is even talking about the new feature. That's a given. That has to be built in. Anytime you build an application, if it is not internet ready, if it is not mobile ready, then it's not an application. That's a new norm in this world. Then the reach and the scalability, that the system has to reach millions of users. Your customers are not global. That nobody wants to do business for their local market. There is no mom and pop shops anymore. Their customers, day one, is somebody that is thousands of miles away. Somebody that can sit at home and buy a product or service. That's how businesses are built. They are built global day one. Is the solution that you are designing that already has the ability to reach, ability to scale, but how fast, how secure, how, what is the quality of that connection? What is the quality of the transaction? Those matter, and that's why the customers move from product A to product B and move to cloud. And finally, how easy to administer all that. Now, these are all the reasons for. These are all the reasons why the change happens in a consumer standpoint. Now, for you, before you learn about a new technology or you do a research, this is what you have to check, whether the technology of your choice, how does it play out now and in the future, when it comes to cost, when it comes to specialty, when it comes to the modernization aspect, is it connecting to the newer world of technologies? Now, let me give one more example. For all of these SaaS providers, take Salesforce, for example. When the artificial intelligence, you know, come up to speed, Salesforce is spending the time to see how they can create an AI platform inside, and that's Salesforce Einstein. IBM is not only spending time on the cloud-related management products. IBM has Watson, the AI engine. Now they are spending their time to see how IBM Watson can be connected to the rest of the ecosystem. Can Salesforce easily access Watson? SAP, can it access Watson? RTISCEA2020 products can access Watson. That's what they are researching. Unless otherwise they connect their product to the rest of the ecosystem, then they are restricting the adoption of Watson. That'll be waste of money for them. So if they want to be successful, then they have to make sure that the asset that they have is connected to the rest of the ecosystem. In the same fashion, if you're going to learn a new technology, let's say that you want to check out, hey, how Pega as a workflow product shaping up, how ServiceNow as a SaaS product is shaping up when it comes to the infrastructure process level. Our operations management. When you want to learn that, your question should be, how is that serving the needs of artificial intelligence? If a company adopts artificial intelligence in their shop, this product survive with that? Will there be proper connection? Will it really work well with these other solutions? Are there connectors available when you ask those questions, you then get an idea, oh, that there's no character. Then you have an opportunity to go build that character. That can be a new business for you. That can be a new capability for you. So building characters is the easiest way for something. If there is already a character out there, you can double click it to see how can I make it better. So that the connection is seamless. That's where Microsoft is spending their time. Microsoft's primary sales pitch is seamless integration. It'll be a good time for me to tell you this produces for you. Now Salesforce and Microsoft and all these guys, they are thinking, how am I going to bundle my services so that I can sell to the customer as everything together? They work on bundling and unbundling. That's how they get the customers and retain their customers and give them a much stronger and better experience by bundling them. Unbundling is a term that I want to spend some time a few minutes later, so I'll reserve it, because that also gives you a core concept of micro SaaS that I'm introducing today. The deep verticalization I already talked about, which is the specialty that these providers are adding. Take, for example, Salesforce. They started as a simple CRM product in the year 1999. Today, they have evolved into an ecosystem. Salesforce is a very attractive ecosystem. They are one of the fastest growing, most respected, highly innovative company. Now, how did they achieve that status from a simple CRM product to a whole ecosystem? How did they achieve? Because they focused on specialization, deep verticalization. They introduced Sales Cloud, Marketing Cloud, Commerce Cloud, CPQ Cloud, Help Cloud, you name it. They just focused on specialty inside their CRM product, and today they are not just a CRM platform. They are ecosystem CRM. They have partnerships with the HCM companies. They have now the work.com solution that helps in the post-COVID realities. Recently they introduced it. I would recommend you to search and learn about work.com and what is that it is doing. They provide services to contact tracing, emergency response, COVID command center, anything that you can think of in the COVID realities. Before you open your colleges, they have solutions how you may want to run your college buildings and student safety and property management. They have solutions. Same is the case for offices. If I want to open my offices in India, then these solutions help me administer the safety and health of our employees in India. So they just have the knack of understanding a way of applying their technology, and they expand to it. That's the third point here. Expanding to the next adjacency. Expanding with new technologies that the customers find useful. AI is useful. How can SaaS adopt AI? Data is critical. How data platforms can come into play. IoT and sensor-driven technologies are picking up speed. How SaaS can take advantage of the sensor-driven technology. Those are the questions that the platform providers are asking. They are embedding those capabilities in their systems. The work.com example that I just talked about, they have features to have a sensor-driven temperature measurement. School or entrance of your offices, when an employee or a student walk in, when you measure the temperature, that sensor is connected to the databases and to the work.com platform, and if the temperature is high, it instantly sends signals to the COVID command center and just alerts the 20 other people that went to school on that day and went to work on that day. It just kind of ignites the whole workflow through contact tracing. So that's how the work.com is embedded with the sensor-driven technologies. And I can go on and list you many examples of how platforms are expanding with these new technologies, and they make their platforms stronger. And same is the case for this partnership. Not the, all these providers like Salesforce or SAP or Microsoft, they are not trying to solve the world of hunger all by themselves. They partnership, they create partnerships with other ecosystems. Salesforce is trying partnership Workday. Salesforce is CRM, Workday is HCM. When they partner, they make their platforms stronger. So ecosystems know how to partner with them. So do not hesitate to learn about any of these technologies. You are connected in that system of ecosystem of ecosystems. It is connected. So that's how the producers, the platform providers are spending their time. So finally, they make it, they want it to be simple. They don't want it to be complicated. So when somebody use an Outlook or a Google Mail, they give all the interfaces, their business applications. So seamlessly integrating business to what we may use on a day-to-day life, that's how they merge technologies into the way that we use them. But these are some of the things that the SaaS providers are spending their time on, and those are some of the examples. Now, in the interest of time, I'll quickly wind up. This is how the service providers are viewing this SaaS evolution, right? Now, one topic we already talked about, which is the way that architectures, the way that when you shift applications from non-cloud to cloud, the architecture has to be adjusted. And monolithic architecture that is designed for static capacity and a close-knit assets like data, etc., that's not going to work out. It has to be transformed to microservices. And that's what you learned last week. And that is a primary opportunity for service providers. Who's going to do all this architectural transformation? Service providers can. The modern technology requires modern QA. You are not going to test the cloud applications the same way that you tested the non-cloud or on-prem applications. Cloud testing requires new tools, new techniques, new virtualization models. Those are all opportunities for service providers. The delivery model itself, the DevOps and pod delivery models, those are the new ways of configuring the SaaS products for usage. That's a new opportunity for service providers. You already asked a question about security. Providing cloud security, providing performance-related measures and guarantees. Those are all opportunities for the service provider. And finally, the knowledge management aspects of what is really happening, how it is implemented, how it is configured, how things can be improved. Those are opportunities for service providers. And then building the talent pool for the future. Organizations like yourselves, colleges, to produce the students with cloud knowledge, that's critically important, and you are playing an important role, and that's a service provider. Now, by putting all these together, a user view, platform provider view, and a service provider view, you can clearly understand that the consumption, production, and services, they drive each other. That's how this whole world of SaaS is evolving. Now, give an example of how these are categorized. Now look at the horizontal box. I told you earlier that customer relationship management, products like Salesforce, Microsoft Dynamics, that's a horizontal SaaS. It's only focused on CRM. HCM, human capital management, Workday, Oracle, these are platforms that are tool management related functions. ERP, you have SAP, you have Oracle, you have some Microsoft business apps, those are all ERP products, that's a horizontal. Similarly for SEO. So you can go on and list those horizontal SaaS. Then came the specialized products for individual industries. So among these horizontal products, consolidated products for healthcare industry, that's your health cloud. Consolidated products for banking and some of those commerce related activities, that's your commerce product. Industry, manufacturing, and some of the industry platforms, industry clouds. Those are the ways that you look at the vertical. Then this whole micro SaaS. These are not a full-blown SaaS product, but these are just add-on to an existing SaaS product just to address a specific problem, right? Now, the micro SaaS is a great idea of unbundling that I talked earlier. They take one specific pain point that the customers have and then work towards it, create a solution that will work for a larger or a bigger SaaS platform or for multiple SaaS platforms. And micro SaaS are the easier way of you solving a problem, a smaller problem, and quickly scaling it up. And if you want to be an entrepreneur, then find out a use case for micro SaaS and build it. Then a large company can buy you out rich. If you want just a job in SaaS, focus on horizontal SaaS. The more and more that you work on horizontal capabilities, you can become an expert and move to the vertical. So that's how the evolution runs. And my last word before I open up questions is, we already talked about the cloud is promising and cloud is the first step in digital transformation. So this is promising, so learn about it. The cloud strategy should be part of an overall digital transformation strategy, otherwise it will be in isolation. So you can talk about cloud, you should talk about the entire businesses if you want to transform businesses. Lift and shift the application to cloud is not enough. You have to transform the application so that the architecture of that changes. Like I said earlier, if you don't touch the architecture, just moving applications to cloud is not going to solve your problem. Your approach also should change. In the traditional approaches, for you to adapt to cloud, you have to use cloud-native approaches. How you approach architecture, how you approach QA, how you check security and performances, all that matter. And when it comes to people, people must be trained in the cloud-related technologies and capabilities. And non-cloud people cannot simply come in and manage it. They have to sit and learn the fundamentals and understand why these shifts happen. And some of what I spoke about will be useful. And cybersecurity and cloud security especially, it's a major concern. And that has to be addressed. And finally, SaaS is here to stay. And that's promising. Let me open it up for questions now.
Good morning again, sir. There are some few questions. What are the open source cloud services available, sir?
See, there are a lot are available. I don't want to list down the whole thing, but this many of these micro SaaS products are open source products that people just create and give it away free so that folks can just download. When it comes to, these can be categorized for specific regulatory related customer experience improvement, data validations and checks. So some of those specific use cases that those products available. And there are also open source workflow products available that you can just use it for configuring your business process and apply. So there are a bunch of them. I don't want to go into any specifics, but I just want to present why that's happening. All you need to worry about before you adapt an open source platform, you just have to check what are the security considerations that they certify, what are the performance related guarantees that they are giving, most importantly, continuity of it, because it has to continue. So if you want to check how strong the user base is before you adapt, or if you just want to use it for experimentation purposes, you don't need to worry about anything. But if you want to use it for a critical purpose, if you want to use any of the open platforms, check how committed they are and that community of open source platform owners are. That will help you adapt. Next question.
So there's a couple of questions on backup and recoverability of data. Do we have to do backup and is recoverability of data when needed is easy to know?
So I think that's a very good question. The cloud providers, if you take AWS or Google, they've also learned a lot. I think about months back, Amazon Web Services was down, and that actually created a lot of users. Things like that have given fantastic learning to the provider. all of these providers, they have what is their backup and recovery mechanism is gold class. They have, they spend more their time and energy and money to make sure that your data, your applications are happening backed up multiple places so that if one goes down, the other one comes up. So these providers are making the backups and recovery part of their. Secondly, they also have many redundant connections and services that they have redundant sets of lines. So if one goes down, instantly the other line, if one database is down, the other database is up and running seamlessly. So when it comes to recovery performance, I think the cloud providers themselves do it. I don't see any reason why the companies also have to do it, but many of the companies, they have their own backup mechanism that on top of the providers, they also back up their data, their applications. So I think it's a good idea to have more data when it comes to fear, like what if things go down. I think it's worth having that. Providers themselves take care of it. Next.
What are the challenges in SAAS that are to be considered in callers?
I think there are many. One we already talked about, cybersecurity, cloud security. Cloud security protocols, security tools and techniques. Oh yeah. When it comes to cloud components, how that change when a cloud product or a cloud platform connects with the assets that folks may have on-prem. You know, today's IT is not all in cloud. Much are in cloud, they also have some on-prem databases and legacy systems on top, which they haven't moved to cloud. So you have a hybrid environment, some on cloud, some on-prem. In that kind of setup, how would a security protocol play? How would the security tools play out? Those are all opportunities for research. When it comes to cloud performance, it's another opportunity for research. What is the way to measure the cloud performance? It all depends on internet performance, bandwidth, things of that nature. Now, how to measure the performance of a cloud implementation? What are some of the things that we have to look into or improve or test? If you want to guarantee a top class performance, those are all cloud performance is another way to improve. And the third one is the interfaces and the simulation that comes in. When it comes to user to machine interface, or machine interface, or machine to user interface, application to application interface, and device to device interface. Yeah? The interfaces change. People want to use applications in very different ways than the way that they used in the past. So what are some of those interface-related advances when it comes to SaaS products? How does that? Can I use my Google Glass to make a comment to improve the database size, the Amazon Web Cloud? Can I use my smartwatch to set a money transaction that is implemented using a tablet? A SaaS product using that. When you ask these questions, then the interfaces and how these interfaces are transparent are useful. Everybody is talking about just a mobile device, you know, mobile device transacting. What about other interfaces? How to simulate? If somebody says my application will work with an Apple Watch, okay, how are you testing? What kind of tools that can help you simulate a watch interface to an application so that you can test it? You can go on and ask those questions and that will give you ideas of what is missing. Those are your research objects.
So there is a couple of questions in live streaming in YouTube. What is your view on community cloud, sir?
Oh, I think that is a fantastic implementation of cloud. One, adapts the cloud sourcing technique. It just brings a community of users together You know, I think the Salesforce is a master. They have these community clouds, and if you go in, their whole Trailblazer is a community cloud. They invite special interest groups to come together, research the topic. So that's a way to bring in any talent that's out there in the globe to come in and learn about the problems that they have and opportunity they have and work on it. So that kind of crowdsourcing their problem is the most powerful way to solve it. Because one person alone or one company alone or one country alone cannot solve the problem. Community clouds are the ways to bring the talent together. The latest example is the World Health Organization is running a community cloud to solve this COVID-related vaccine development and activities. By means of bringing scholars, doctors, nurses together, they put the world of knowledge when it comes to anything that they learn about this COVID and this whole pandemic. They can speed up the way that they can develop the vaccine, that they can adjust all the solutions. So that's a fantastic way of bringing in. Crowdsourcing is the foundation for community clouds. That's working. And that's a way that you bring the world together to solve a problem.
Next question is, how could our existing data center and infrastructure approaches, technologies can be used for this cloud?
Oh, that's a lot of advancements. I think I said infrastructure was the easiest thing for cloud movement. I commented that earlier. The databases, because they're sitting in servers. And then came the workaround data, the analytics, data administration, data reporting, all that were the advancements that is mature now. There are millions of products. If I were you, I'd like to learn more about Oracle's autonomous database. What does that mean? How is that improving the way that the company uses database? Learn about that. Learn about Tableau, how an attractive analytics tool platforms like Tableau can do wonders that do data visualization, data presentation. Learn about that. So when it comes to database administration, data reporting, data visualization, data analytics, the world is going very fast. But there's another reason why this is critically important. When it comes to artificial intelligence, is nothing but an algorithm, the data behind that algorithm, and the devices or interfaces that connect these two. The data are learning. Interpretation is critically important. The data is a major component. If you're interested in it, learn it. That is a super critical area. That is going to be an evergreen field. I think we are running more than the time, but I'm okay to spend a few more minutes, but you can actually decide to go.
Yeah, I just consolidate like a few more interesting questions. There is one question, but say a few with that. Sir, can you say a few words about DigitalOcean? Comment on cloud platform for startups.
I don't know what is DigitalOcean mean. It's probably they mean the whole slew of the products that are addressing the transformational needs that the customers have as they try to modernize their environment. Probably they mean it. But let me answer this other question. What are some of the startups? I told earlier that MicroSAAS is a fantastic way. As you learn more about a existing product, a Salesforce or SAP or Oracle, whatever that technologies that you learn, and however way that it has been implemented, a sales cloud implementation or a health cloud implementation, whatever the implementation could be. But if you question, what are some of those unaddressed features? That the product is fantastic, but something is missing. If you find that out as you learn, and if you feel that what you find out is a real pain for many users, and they're wasting their time, they're wasting their money, because because they are trying to solve the same problem. And those are opportunities for you to start something. It could be as small as a micro SaaS. All of those micro SaaS products that I have listed, they are companies of 2 people or 3. The 1 or 2 people coming up with an idea and developing a solution, starting a new business. All it requires is for you to understand what you're saying. For that, you need to talk to the users, not people like me. I'm a service provider. You have to talk to the real users of the technology of your choice and understand what is the pain that they have when the Salesforce technology, when they use an Oracle Autonomous Database, SAP, SuccessFactor, Qualtrics, or whatever that may be. When they use it, in your topic of interest, what is the pain that they have? And if you understand that the pain is actually universal, not just one, those are your startup ideas.
The next question is, what is the difference in cloud computing and computing for mobiles?
I don't think that there is any difference, because the moment you talk about mobile, and the moment you talk about mobile computing, then you are connecting something over the internet. Otherwise, mobile computing is meaningless. Your device, a mobile device, you are connecting to a database. So it's not cloud, it's only cloud computing. So mobile computing is cloud computing.
Let me ask
that.
Sir, next question. Sir, Mr. Anmol, can you proceed up to 5 IP? We, I think a lot of questions are there. Will you be able to follow up 5 IP, up to 5 IP? Other 20 minutes. Yeah, I can. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. Sir, then another request is, how is the functionality provided in cloud computing?
In cloud, in my opinion, in cloud, everything is on demand. Because that's how the providers have designed their application. It's not like a, you know, the whole slew of their packages and everything that they have in their ecosystem come to the call. Customers, I earlier told you, right, in slide 2, when I was talking about the cost of on-prem versus cost of cloud, when I compared, I told you that there are a lot of hidden costs when it comes to those iceberg picture. The hidden cost of the on-prem setup or the traditional home-built application setup, the infrastructure, the network, the training, implementing the maintenance, all that is gone in cloud computing. Only the subscription fee alone is the cost when it comes to cloud, because you just subscribe and you get access. Like that, you actually subscribe, that is on demand. You on demand get the feature that you need. They unbundle their features so that you pay a very nominal fee. This whole $1 is like a few dollars per user. Gone are the days when folks needed millions of dollars to build an application. Now all they need is $100. This $100 that they sign up and get access to whatever they're basically so that they want to do, a couple of dollars that they can build a full-blown application. So everything is on demand. And you just subscribe what you want, pay for what you use, and then go on and build your application.
The next question is continuation of, like, yeah, as I gave the last question, how do vendors charge for services?
So I think it's all, like I said, it's a subscription. Depending on what is the feature that you need, if you sign up with Salesforce, they clearly put it that you need just a basic implementation of a Sales Cloud. And here is a per user fee. And the per user fee would be a few dollars. And if you think that my users are like 1,000 users, then you just pay for those 1,000. And you just subscribe and you increase your user base, you pay more. If the user base comes down, you pay less. The user base go up, you pay more. It's all subscription based, the volume based. So they just device their payment mechanism per user. Yeah. Earlier, per license. The license cost has now transformed into per user. And that's an easier way. They just charge you. It won't bother you. Although that the effort is to pay a 5 rupee per user, it won't bother you. But then when you put 5 million users, then it suddenly become 5 rupee. 5 million, you have 25 million rupees as payment. But that's only funny because if you increase your 5 users to 5 users, your business will now become bigger and you would not hesitate to pay a 5 million rupee to the provider. So their charging mechanism is subscription. Their charging mechanism is transaction based. Their charging mechanism is part of volume. That way, you only pay for what you're using. That's how the vendors are charging. That's a very smart way of pricing, and that works.
So how does traditional software licensing apply in the cloud world?
It's a lot different, because the traditional software licensing world, 30 years back, you practically pay in license. You just buy it, use it, but you pay every time additional fee when it comes to upgrades, right? That changed when they moved from the on-prem to the cloud. In cloud, when this whole cloud computing was not mature in the past, again, you pay license fee and you get the product. It's just coming over the cloud, and whenever the provider upgrades the product, he just upgrades it without even you knowing it most of the times, or they just tell you in advance and charge you a fee when they upgrade to the next version. That's how it was. In today's economy, licensing fee is the least that customers pay. If they pay $100 for license, the services and everything else is like 4 times license, 5 times or 10 times. The licensing part is kind of punk. And the biggest attraction that all these products has, there's no licensing fee for many of the products. All they say is no licensing. You just sign up. If you are the only user, you just pay me every month this much money. If you add more users, just increase your payment. So they just translate the sunk cost of licensing fee into a variable cost used on what you use for, which is actually a serious advantage to businesses. A business owner, let's say that I'm running the business, let's say that I'm the chief financial officer of Nike. If I'm the chief financial officer, I never would like a cost that just goes away, a cost that just sounds, that I just put the money and I never get that back. That will not be a good use of the CFO. A CFO would like to spend only when you need. And for whatever that I spent, I have to get some returns. That's how CFOs operate. Now, in situations like that, this licensing cost will not be a topic of interest to the CFO. The topic of interest is, if Nike architect walks into the CFO office and say, this application, or this kind of a business pro, that we have a million users in the world, I can overnight roll it out to the million users, and you will get sales improvement in the first month, if I do this. Now the CFO would like to know is that valid? If this goes in, I get a million sales transactions happen in these countries. The answer is yes. You will instantly pay for that million user each. But then these companies all have arrangements with companies like Salesforce or SAP, and they have their own ways of using the product. So licensing fee is the last thing that SaaS world is worrying about. What SaaS world is worrying about is the application of the product. Will this be useful? Will this address my problem? Will this guarantee the security? Is this scalable? That's how they worry about. That's exactly how they should have technologies. They should not be worrying about how the network will work or how the connectors will. That's not how business should worry about. So I think it is going in the right direction of the core, focus on your core business. everything else. Somebody else.
So there are
vendors
available. Is there
performance
in cloud vendors?
Absolutely. There are variations because the design that providers have and your application is in certain shape. Many times the applications are the problem when it comes to that's why I said lift and shift alone is not good enough. We have to adjust the applications, align to the cloud architecture. So monolithic architecture has to be microservices architecture for you to take advantage of the cloud platform. So yes, the performance varies. Both of that is because of your applications. But then these product vendors also, their own product maturity give that. Oracle Prometure, you may not see performance with them. But then if you buy a product from an unknown party, their maturity of their product may not be good. So that can create a performance bottleneck. So there are reasons why these performance, okay? The short answer is yes, there are variations. You should check that out. Then we reach the time.
Yeah, one last question. Then how do we justify our performance? So do we have to check with multiple cloud vendors?
I think it's worth asking those questions to the provider. What is the performance guarantees that they give you? And what are the factors that think nothing wrong in asking them, kind of parking it before you do provide it? At the same time, you should also check. That's why this modern QA comes into play. When you test it, quality assurance, when I say QA is quality assurance, when you do quality of your standard, you have to make sure that performance is tested as part of your application. Before you roll out your solution to your user, how is it performing? Now, crowd testing helps you because you can test how this application would perform in this remote corner of Mylapore in Chennai. Because you don't know, sitting in the US, you don't know the network bandwidth and internet bandwidth and the environmental factors of Mylapore, Chennai. You need to test this in Mylapore, Chennai to test my application. So this whole crowd of hiring some testers from that community, have them test my application before I roll out to go the entire Chennai, Chennai is my target market. Before I roll it out, I will test it out in different places. So modern QA helps you.
Okay.
Thank you very much for your informative and interactive session. And we are fortunate to have Mr. Andrew Ganapati, Vice President, to Loved on clouds of evolution, and I think our participants are very eagerly asking a lot of clarifications. You have given your best word and also very knowledgeable, and you have given all the solutions to our participants. They are very happy. I think one of our students has asked, what is the preliminary request to become a cloud specialist? What is the pre-request? What are the things to be learned? One of our students has asked.
No, I think the prerequisite is just the interest. You should have that interest. If you have the interest, and if you have the passion, you will just learn it and you'll be a master. Just be passionate, be curious, and learn whatever that comes your way.
True,
right.
But as a student, he wants to know his technology, he has to learn first. That's why he's asking.
Oh, okay. I think that, I don't know, all these technologies are pretty useful. You know, just to give you, if I were to know, what are some of the free resources that are available for me to learn SAAS technology? That would be the way that I would check. Salesforce Trailblazer. That gives you a free way of the fundamentals of cloud, how to use Salesforce. And they also certify you free of charges. So if you search the net, you'll find out those links that are available for students, teachers, or academic institutions. Just go and sign up. The resources are available free. Same kind of setup you have with SAP or Oracle. Check what are those three links that you thought about fundamentals. And that will tell you how to use Salesforce sales transformation. Do some sample applications, learn them, get certified. Within a few weeks, you'll be a sales certified developer. Then these companies will just hire you, or you can do whatever research there. So the easiest way is to find those free resources that are available. Pick any platform. Salesforce is an easy and a quick platform. Pick a technology like that. Learn. So I would put the Salesforce as a good way to start.
Thank you very much. Now I request Lavanya, Dr. Lavanya, Associate Professor, Department of Computer Science, to propose vote of thanks.
Yeah. It's an honor to propose vote of thanks at this international webinar on recent trends in intelligence systems, cloud and enterprise computing. Foremost, I thank Almighty for blessing us with good health and peace in this global pandemic condition. I thank our university authorities for their support to conduct this international webinar. A sincere thanks to Mr. Anbu Ganapathy, our resource person, Senior Vice President and Global Markets Head, CTS, New Jersey, USA, for his enlightening talk on cloud SaaS evolution. It was very informative and an eye-opener session for all of us, sir. Thank you, sir, for joining us in this raw weather too. A week-long wait was indeed worthful. I take this opportunity to thank our HOD and our professors of our department for their support. I thank all the participants for their active participation, and I thank all our students and scholars for their timely support. Our sincere gratitude for Professor PL.Chithra for arranging this international webinar for disseminating knowledge. Thank you all.
Thank you so much. So I take this opportunity to thank our speaker, energetic speaker, and potential speaker for sharing his wonderful knowledge with the 25 years of experience to our University of Madras students and participants. Thank you once again, Mr. Anbu Ganapathy Mukhidadi. Thank you so much for spending your valuable and precious time with us. And we request you to keep in touch and help our department. Thank you so much.
Bye bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you. Goodbye. Thank you, Lavanya, for your wonderful coordination and all the participants. Thank you so much for all your cooperation. Thank you so much. The feedback form is given in the link. All of you fill up and you will get the certificate within 2 days. Everyone will get. It will be open for another 20 minutes. All of you please fill up. It is posted in the WhatsApp group also. And you can take up and you can fill up. And all of you will get your certificates. Thank you for your wonderful participation. And I think we have received knowledge out of our cloud computing. Thank you so much. For your